Hi everyone, that Friday's NFP miss has been such a relief before this week's inflation data in the US. Happy, light and cheery. Here is what to expect from the week ahead. Also, forget about everything we talked about last week about the fact that the substantial progress in the US jobs market would add some fuel to the inflation debate and revive the Fed hawks and push some investors to start prepping for a tighter Federal Reserve policy and move assets from volatile growth stocks to the value stocks, so the so-called reflation trade, and that you should start picking some good reflation stocks to make sure to avoid a potential downside correction in Nasdaq, for example. That ain't happening because the US jobs data release on Friday was a huge and impressive miss, one of the biggest, if not the biggest, that I've seen since more than a decade. So it's not only the asset valuations that went ahead of themselves, apparently, but the expectations have as well. From the million non-farm job additions expected by analysts last week, only some 260,000 has materialized. Also, last month's figure was revised down. The private payrolls missed as big as the NFPs. Oh, and by the way, the manufacturing payrolls printed a negative 18,000. So the US jobless rate unexpectedly ticked higher to 6.1%. That was bad, though the average pay improved a little, but just a little. So you see, everything is going well this Monday. The whole thing is just a problem for some 8 million jobless Americans who are looking for a job still, but not for investors, not for the market, for whom it was more fear than harm. And I think it was a glorious moment for Jay Powell as well, who was right about the fact that the US economy continues needing more monetary support, and everyone else was wrong. So the big NFP miss we've seen on Friday has only been a sigh of relief for all investors out there who were actually wondering what would happen to the market and their holdings if we had really seen the data hitting the million mark on Friday. But, you know, let's not think of bad things this Monday and concentrate on the good. The good thing is that you can just continue buying whatever you want right now without worrying too much about when and how the Fed would pull away the punch bowl, because it won't happen anytime soon. We don't even know when would it happen or would it ever happen, to be honest, but we know that it won't happen so soon. So that's a good thing for your average investor. Now, let the trading week start with light and happy feeling. Then the excess liquidity is here to soothe the market nerves, as I said. It's still a good idea, in my opinion, to follow the reflation trade, but there is no hurry right now, really. It really feels like an important exam has been just pushed to a further date, and you now have plenty of time to revise the things that you didn't know before. So that's good news. Now, it's not all rose, of course, never is. We could well see this post-NFP high to leave its place to some hangover by this Wednesday, when the US will announce the April inflation data. So the headline inflation is expected to have jumped to 3.6% from 2.6% printed a month earlier and from 1.7% printed 2 months earlier. So just to give you an idea on how fast these inflation numbers could pick up momentum. But even before that, we could actually see the Chinese producer prices due Tuesday, which could actually already dampen the investor mood if producer prices confirm a jump to 6.6% in April from 4.4% printed a month earlier. So the rapid rise in oil and commodity prices, global shortages, slow logistics globally as well, are all pointing at higher inflation globally. But if you're thinking, why should I worry if the Fed remains accommodative on its monetary policy regardless of the inflation levels? Well, you're right. That's the thing, right? As long as the US jobs data remains weak, the Fed will do whatever is in its power to maintain its monetary policy, its financial conditions as loose as possible, even though it appears that this loose monetary policy serves to the ever-wealthy investors more than it serves to the 8 million jobless Americans out there. But that's not your problem. So yes, the investor sentiment is great. there is just this inflation barrier this week on Wednesday where you should be a little bit careful. But other than that, there is no material risk whatsoever to the positive trend in the equity markets that we see right now. Moreover, the earnings season is mostly behind us in the US. Great, great earnings season, by the way. 86% of the S&P 500 companies that reported earnings so far just topped analyst expectations. Even though I know what you're thinking that is analyst expectations look like a joke at the moment, especially after last Friday's scandalous NFP miss, but still, you only have those expectations in hand, so you will need to do with them. Now, some names that will come to the spotlight on this week's corporate calendar are the very Biontech today. There is absolutely no doubt that Biontech had a great, great first quarter thanks to the COVID vaccine. And even the aggressive sell-off we've seen last week on news that the vaccine patent would be temporarily just forgotten to allow other companies to copy the COVID vaccine to save more lives globally more rapidly. Well, that has been a good dip buying opportunity for the investors who actually believe that BioNTech will certainly find enough people to sell its vaccines to for the weeks and the months and the quarters ahead. They will continue seeing more demand than what they could satisfy anyway. So why bother if others just jump in? And we don't even know if we need to get the vaccine regularly. I mean, imagine if that's the case. So BioNTech remain a lucrative business. Even if you see a little lack of appetite, I don't think that there is anything that threatens this company's revenues for a couple of more quarters, as I said. On Wednesday, the dating app Bumble and the gaming platform Roblox, which freshly went public, will release their first quarter earnings. And I believe there's a little chance we see earnings stimulate the taste buds of investors for the X dating app out there. So I'm talking about Bumble. But Roblox is holding on quite well. It will be interesting to see a solid growth in its community of users and developers. So remember, there are people on Roblox creating games and they are earning money on their creations on this application. So it's not your regular gaming platform. It's very much in line with today's mentality of putting the individuals to the front line of the business, both from demand and from supply perspective. So I continue liking Roblox and its business, and the actual soft Fed expectation environment could give a chance to the stock price to finally pick up some momentum. Still, even though we've seen it lagging in the first weeks of its trading after an impressive IPO. On Thursday, the Chinese tech giant Alibaba will release earnings. The stock price is having some hard time even after the government announced a less huge than expected antitrust fine in China for the iconic Jack Ma's tech giant. Alibaba is still a solid business in my opinion, but investors are nowhere to be found nowadays. So could it be an opportunity for the long-term investors is yet to be seen. But above all, Disney earnings on Thursday will be under the spotlight as the company announced it reached the 100 million subscriber threshold in March. So that was just after 60 months into the video streaming business. Now, the expectations for Disney are strong, but investors won't get too excited before the earnings announcement on Thursday, as Netflix, its major competitor, just missed estimates big time in the first quarter a couple of weeks earlier. So we may see a similar disappointment in the Disney's first quarter results. But if I had the choice between investing in Netflix or investing in Disney, I would choose Disney, as the end of the pandemic will be promising for its more lucrative themes park. So you have a great pandemic play with Disney, but you have an even greater post-pandemic hedge. So it's probably as good as investing in commodities. Now, speaking of commodities, one last word on oil and on gold. Oil is being supported by the latest cyber attack on the US Colonial Pipeline, which should help the barrel of US crude reaching the $68 level. I expect to see some resistance at the 68-70 region. We could see some price pullback, but it looks like the prospects of improved global demand will attract dip buyers to this market, and the price pullbacks could actually be some interesting dip buying opportunities for short-term oil traders. Now, last but not least, gold is doing just fine, and gold bulls have all cards in their hands to make a successful attempt to the $1,850-$1,852 area. The area including the 200-day moving average on the sweet combination of the rising inflation expectations and the soft US yields thanks to an unquestionably dovish Fed policy. This is all for today. I'm Ipek Ozkardeskaya, and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and insightful to you. Please do not hesitate to follow us on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.